Well, hello, welcome everyone. My name is Jorge Fanjul, and I am the director focused on government legitimacy here at the Center for Public Impact. CPI is a global nonprofit whose mission is to help reimagine government so that it works better for everyone. We welcome everyone to the Building Trust in Local Government webinar, and we're so excited to connect with each and every one of you today. Thank you for joining us today. Let's quickly go over our agenda. We have a fun, packed day of a lot that we're going to try to get through in 90 minutes. But if you do need a break, please feel free to take one at any point. This will be recorded and shared with you afterwards on our website. We've got a lot going on today, but first let me share a brief summary as we begin of the key learnings from the Earned Legitimacy Design team. I'll be talking about what earned legitimacy is and how we define it. And then really for the stars of the show is we're going to be followed by a panel discussion with some of the superstars from each of our local municipalities that participated in the Earned Legitimacy Learning Cohort Program. To kick us off, I'd like to start giving a quick overview of some of the definitions that we used in the program. Don't worry, as some of these are new to you, a lot of them are meant to create a common language around themes that many of us already know. Now, we know that language matters all the time, and especially when it comes to earning trust. So as we try to really be intentional about this at CPI, we pulled together a CPI dictionary with some common words that you'll be able to find in the Zoom chat. So today, let's really focus on this concept of earned legitimacy, and we'll begin by how CPI defines earned legitimacy. So we view legitimacy as the open and trusting relationship between government and communities. We believe that more effective governance really comes from an increase in legitimacy, in that feeling of trust that residents have with their community. Given that residents are generally more communicative and more open with leaders that they actually believe in and trust. So when we say legitimacy, we want to be clear that we're talking about trust. And it's really about government centering the human experience and the lived experience of the residents they serve. Now, we know all relationships require work. We know that aside from the relationship that you have with your family at home, you have relationships with your friends and relationships with society as a whole. But all of these require work. Think about those relationships in your life. For government officials and community, that's no different. So whether we're talking about familial, platonic, or even romantic relationships, that relationship between government and community requires just as much time, and it needs to be cultivated and maintained over time. So it's really well known, just like in our other relationships, that the level of time and commitment that we put into creating that trust in those other relationships, the byproduct is ultimately more effort, more energy, more communication, more trust, being able to basically deal with issues together better. And it's no different, again, with this relationship that we're talking about today between government and community. And why is that? Because people really want to be heard. At CPI, we've simply acknowledged that for local government officials interested in cultivating relationships centered around trust and going deeper with their communities, that needs to be earned. And that's earned legitimacy. And it requires some effort. So just like everything that's earned, whether you earn a college degree or earn a black belt in some martial art, you're fighting for it. You're earning it. And government has to work, has to earn that trust and that feeling of legitimacy. Now, some of this is probably resonating with many of you already because it's work that you're already doing. What we're talking about at CPI, and when we talk about the government legitimacy learning cohort, we're talking about putting people together that are doing the work much more intentionally. Many of the programs that we've done at CPI, even predating earned legitimacy, we saw that there was always a component of government having to communicate with community and the tensions that are inherent in there. So we designed this and really tried to build a program around intentionally focusing on what it means to really really focus on that specific problem rather than looking at it as an afterthought or looking at it as a part of other work. Let's look at the issue of legitimacy and trust between government and community. So now we understand a little bit of why we did the program, and I appreciate you being with me this long, right, to give you that explanation. But it is very important because the support that local government officials and their communities need here is can be really, really, really exhaustive. So we created this cohort to be a 10-week program that really hyper-focuses on us serving as a learning partner for each of our cities. Now, what's a learning partner? You know, new terminology here. Kind of view it as going to the gym and having a trainer. And that trainer is not lifting weights for you, but they are giving you tools and techniques that they've learned from others, that they've designed, that they've tested, and really bringing it to you so that you can help better work out and identify your strengths and weaknesses and help to guide you in developing a plan to get to where you want to be. And that's really what a learning partner is. In this program, we invested in building the exercises, the tools, and the techniques to support each of our municipalities towards achieving greater legitimacy. So our 10-week program was organized into three phases. The first was examining where power sits, then sharing power, and reimagining more legitimate systems. So it's kind of a journey. We prefer to look at it in that term. We had four municipalities hailing from different parts of the country, very diverse communities representing different levels of government. We had Harris County, Texas, Salt Lake City, Utah, Carlton County, Minnesota, and Detroit, Michigan. Throughout all of this work, our cohort practiced five core values that we believe are critical to earning the trust of communities. What are these? Well, first, before I even go into them, I want to mention they're in a circle. Why? And much like any circle, there is no part that's more important than another, right? That's why it's in a perfect circle, because these values need to be perfectly synchronous with one another. They are curiosity, open-mindedness, humility, accountability, and equity. So in just a moment, you're going to hear from our learning liaisons and our design team that are going to talk to you about their experiences with these municipalities and their experiences in building out the program. Before I pass it over, I just want to introduce them and say their names so you all know who they are. Nijay Nelson, Brian Zuluaga, and John Burgoyne. And they're all going to be talking to you about their team's focus, how the team they worked with really demonstrated the values. And then we're going to do a quick introduction to our team member panelists. So without further ado, I'm so, so excited to pass it over to our learning liaisons as they share these stories. First, I'd like to bring on Brian Zuluaga, who had Salt Lake City. Over to you, Brian.
Thank you so much, Jorge. And thank you for everyone in attendance today. So my name is Brian Zuluaga, and I had the great pleasure of serving as a learning liaison with two local governments in the Earn Legitimacy Learning Cohort. So the first team that I'll speak about today is Salt Lake City, Utah. So Salt Lake City joined the cohort with an intention to focus on police equity. Actually, several of the team members have supported the city's racial equity and policing commission. So the team's participation in the program has greatly influenced how they think about this work. With regards to the values that Jorge was just mentioning, the value that I think the Salt Lake City team demonstrated is open-mindedness. With policing and police reform, you know, it's often a topic that can be quite divisive. And I noticed that during the community listening sessions and the co-creation sessions, the team continuously demonstrated and exemplified a willingness to understand and listen to novel ideas from residents. You know, I'll even mention that the team had one member that was a part of the Salt Lake City Police Force who was incredibly graceful and open-minded in hearing, you know, residents talk about her own profession as well as her colleagues. So I'll shout out that team member, but I also have to shout out one of today's panelists, Coletta Lynch, who served as a huge leader for the team. You all will have the opportunity to hear from Coletta today, but I'll just say, you know, Coletta's Salt Lake City's first chief equity officer, and I really appreciated her openness in weaving in the learnings from the program into her role and responsibility as the equity officer for the city. And so just really excited to have you all listen directly from her and hear about her personal experiences. And so moving forward to the second local government team that I had the opportunity to work with was Harris County, Texas. Harris County had a team that primarily consisted of the Community Services Department, but we also had individuals from other departments within the county, such as the Public Health Department. We also had an individual from the Economic Opportunity and Equity Department. So although we had a variety of departments represented within this team, the team focused on affordable housing, which is, of course, an issue that transcends more than just one governmental department. And so it was great to see the synergy and the cross-departmental work that they were engaging in. And again, in terms of what value I believe this team exemplified, I truly think it has to be equity. As I think about the team's planning for the co-creation session with the community residents, equity was truly at the forefront at the planning and logistics for the event. As we were planning for the event, the team often brought up the importance of having interpreters at the session if necessary. Also, the team decided to reserve a space within the Community Services Department for residents who, you know, might not have internet access or have the ability to access the Zoom room for the co-creation session. And I'll also add that the residents who traveled to the Community Services Department were also reimbursed with a bus pass for their travel costs. And so there was truly an equitable approach to ensuring that the co-creation session was accessible for the residents. And at the center of this preparation was one of our panels today, Tanisha Franks, who invited residents to the session and welcomed them in person at the Community Services Department. So very excited to have her featured today as one of the speakers. And so that actually concludes my personal reflections on the two teams that I served as a learning liaison for. And I'll happily pass the mic to my fellow learning liaison, Nijay Nelson.
Thank you, Ryan. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nijay Nelson, and I had the amazing pleasure of serving as the learner liaison for the City of Detroit. As a collective, this team, they were amazing to work with, honestly, not only because of their brilliance and the intentionality that they brought to each and every workshop every week, but honestly because of who they were as people. They were incredibly kind, funny. Even though it was just Zoom, I really enjoyed getting to learn with them and from them over the 10 weeks. As a core team, Detroit came in laser focused with a priority focused on wanting to improve the relationship that existed between the local government and residents with disabilities. From week one, I really appreciated how this team naturally embodied the value of humility without any coaching from me in CPI. Like at the beginning, regularly in workshops, I heard many of them talk about their desire to shift from creating solutions alone and instead begin to center the needs and voices of residents in their processes. Over the 10 weeks, I learned so much from this team about the importance of humility and practically how to embody it just as a byproduct of getting to work with them every week. A story that stands out to me where I got to really see this humility in action was when we were planning for the initial community listening sessions. Ahead of these community listening sessions where they were interviewing residents, we spent a couple of workshops and internal meetings drafting questions and doing some practice runs. That way they could feel prepared. Ahead of these community listening sessions, collectively, we knew two things. We knew that we didn't want them to feel super transactional where folks just felt like we were taking from them. And we also knew we didn't want them to feel super corporate and businessy But instead, we wanted it to feel like a peer-to-peer connection so that they could really hear from residents about what they were seeing in their community and what they were hearing. So we spent a lot of time brainstorming what are some potential personal stories we can share to really create that vulnerability and create that peer-to-peer connection. While we were doing this, it was when Alaremi, one of our panelists who you'll get to hear later today, pointed out something really important. He pointed out how while vulnerability is incredibly important, he also noted that often public servants take up a lot of space and how community listening sessions are a unique opportunity where public servants can share power and how we should make the most of this by really trying to strike the right balance. I know for myself and I know for other folks on the team, we really appreciated this flag to make sure that we weren't like perpetuating these systems of power, that we were really trying to share it. While this is one nugget that like I will forever like keep from Alaremi and the team, I'm super excited that he's here today and we'll continue to be able to hear some additional nuggets of wisdom from him later this afternoon. And on that note, I'm gonna pass it over to my colleague, John, to give a quick summary of his team.
Thank you, Najee, and hello, everyone. My name is John Burgoyne. I served as the program manager for the learning cohort and a learning liaison for Carleton County. Carleton County decided to focus on building a stronger sense of connection with their most rural communities. For some context, Carleton, unlike the other members of the learning cohort, is a really small rural place in Minnesota that has a population of less than 40,000. So their diverse perspective really helped us better understand how to build trust in different contexts throughout the country. And I had a great opportunity to be able to visit Carleton County and help support them in facilitating some community listening. And one of the things that really stood out was how they embodied accountability in all that they did. And when we think about accountability in terms of building trust, we think about being accountable to communities, particularly those that are most impacted by systemic inequities. And that's something that Carleton County's core team did throughout the program. Two quick stories on how they did this. One was with their county board. So one of the ideas that came out of the community listening sessions wasn't that novel, but it was the idea that all county government employees should be trained in cultural competencies so that they could be more responsive and sensitive to the needs of the communities they're working with. And so as part of the final recommendations to the board, the core team recommended everyone's trained on diversity, equity, inclusion, and trauma-informed care, something that not all board members had necessarily been trained on. And this was approved so that now every employee in the county will have these trainings moving forward. Another example is where they held CPI accountable. We used language that they called us out on throughout the workshop, such as the word stakeholder. This, as the core team let us know, Donna spoke up and said this is something that has really violent connotations when you think about Indigenous communities and the idea of planting a stake in someone's land. So we really appreciated that feedback so that as a learning partner, we could grow and improve in the way that we communicate moving forward. And the last thing I want to do is shout out Sue Zimslody. You were an incredible community co-lead throughout the program, and we're really excited. I'm really excited for everyone to be able to hear from you later on. You embodied accountability throughout the program. One of the examples was when we were talking about an existing initiative within the county, this Well Within Reach campaign that was designed to promote well-being within the county. Sue called us out and said, I have not heard of this, and I've talked to community members who also haven't heard of it. So we really need to not just make this a marketing campaign, but really an initiative that's felt in all corners of the county. Thank you, Sue. I'm excited for everyone else to learn from you. And now I'm going to pass it over to Alejandra Montoya, who's going to take a step back and say, what are some of the bigger learnings across the counties and cities we worked with? So over to you, Alejandra.
Yeah, thank you so much, John. My name is Alejandra Montoya, and I led the impact evaluation for the Earned Legitimacy Learning Cohort. And as a learning partner, CPI is really interested in helping others learn how to reimagine government and also learn about the impact of our programs. So curiosity is one of our Earned Legitimacy values. And with this impact evaluation process, we really embraced it by talking to our participants about their experiences and how we may improve our programming for future reference, and then also looking at the data we collected throughout the program from various lenses to gather different insights on how our teachings and how our programs benefited the different participants. So we managed to pull some themes from all this information that we believe are essential to building legitimacy and trust. So measuring the level of trust and the quality of trust and relationships is difficult because it varies person by person. But by identifying these four themes, we're really highlighting four values that are critical for building strong and trustful relationships between the government and the community. So our first theme is humanizing and demystifying government. So humanizing and demystifying government is really about making government accessible and approachable. So government is often viewed as this complex institution that has many twists and turns and a bureaucracy that makes it very difficult to navigate. So in order to build trust, we believe it's important to help community members understand that real people are behind government work and that it is possible to untangle government's complexities. Because community members often forget that people are the driving mechanism of government initiatives, it's important for public servants to center their residents in their work. By centering residents in governmental processes, residents may feel more comfortable and connected to public servants, and public servants can also better understand the needs of community members. An interactive government can work to improve social and economic conditions and with and for its community members, but centering residents can't function without first understanding the historical and spatial context of neighborhoods, towns, and cities. Recognizing the past harms perpetuated by government is critical to creating strong relationships and strong bonds between public servants and community members. By being vulnerable and recognizing the hardships of marginalized communities, governments and public servants can improve levels of trust. And finally, none of this can be done without hope. Hope is powerful in that it motivates public servants, elected officials, and community members to progress. In our current political climate, both internationally and locally, I think most people can relate to how frustrating it is to search for hope and maintain hope. However, hope should not disappear at the first sign of danger. By realizing the power that hope has in creating systemic change, governments and communities can continue to grow and improve the livelihoods of their peers. Without hope, earning trust and legitimacy is not possible. And with that, I will pass it back to Jorge to keep this event going.
Thank you, Alejandra and John, Nijay and Brian, for all of the work that you put into this. Thank you all for staying with us. As promised, we're going to be giving you a 10-minute break. And then when we come back, really the stars of our webinar today, led by our special guest from National League of Cities, Jen Steinfeld, and our panelists. So thank you, Sue, Remy, Tanisha, and Coletta for joining us. You heard them all mentioned by Learning Liaisons. They are waiting to speak to you in a little under 10 minutes. So please take a break, get some water, get some coffee, and we'll see you soon.
I'm on top of the world. Tried to cut these corners, try to take the easy way. I kept on falling short of something. I could have gave up then, but then again I couldn't have, cause I've traveled all this way for something. I take it in, but don't look down. 'Cause I'm on top of the world, hey.
Best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk the guy, go banging on his door.
You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock,
yeah.
You can move a mountain, you can break rocks.
You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you go find yourself.
Standing in the Hall of Fame. You can run the mile, you can walk straight through hell with a smile.
You could be the hero, you could get the gold. Breaking all the records they thought never could be broke.
Yeah, do it for your people, do it for your pride. And you're never gonna know if you never even try.
Do it for your country, do it for your name. 'Cause there's gonna be a day when you're
standing in the Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And the world's gonna know your name. Politicians, be preachers, yeah. Be believers, be leaders. Be astronauts, be champions. Be truth seekers. Be students, be teachers. Be politicians, be preachers,
preachers.
Be believers, be leaders. Be astronauts, be champions.
Standing in the Hall of Fame.
And the world's gonna know your name.
Well, welcome back, everyone. For those of you that are just joining us, my name is Jorge Fanjul, and I am a director here at the Center for Public Impact focused on government legitimacy and a former New York City public servant. And I'm so excited to mention that because we are joined with a group of public servants today in this superstar panel. And all of these individuals participated in the Earn Legitimacy Learning Cohort. There's a saying that was once shared with me by a mentor that knowledge that isn't shared is knowledge that's lost. And no one can really tell the story of what it was to go on this journey of bridging the gap between trust and increasing government legitimacy than the participants of the program themselves, because they experienced it firsthand. So we're so honored to be joining them today. And we sourced questions for them from this audience, from our audience members, for those of you that registered, and we're going to do our best to go through as many of them as possible. I'm also incredibly excited to welcome another public servant, former public servant here, Jennifer Steinfeld, who serves currently as the Director of Entrepreneurship and Economic Development for the National League of Cities. Wow, what a superstar. And prior to joining NLC, Jen was a public servant as the Director of Strategic Partnerships and Economic Opportunity in the great city of Providence, Rhode Island. Jen, we're so lucky to have you, and thank you so much for emceeing this panel for us.
Well, thank you for having me, and I always forget I have this tiny microphone. It felt like what better day to use the tiny microphone than working with all of these wonderful people. So I learned so much already from just our opening statements, but one thing that John and the folks in Carlton County remind me is the importance of trauma-informed work. I think especially after these last 2 years, we can all use a little more trauma-informed work. So since we've just gone through a transition, I hope you'll all bear with me and just do, we're going to do 3 deep breaths together. So breathe in and think about, just notice your body sitting in the chair, your feet on the floor, and breathe out. Breathe in again. And just notice your air moving through your breathing body and breathe out. And then a third breath in. And just notice if there are any other breathing bodies in the room with you, all of those that we're here to serve, all of those out in the world. And if there's anyone whose body is no longer breathing that you want to bring into this room with you, I think for me, that's always the folks that I'm here working on behalf of are always not always with us still. So thank you for bearing with me on that. As Jorge mentioned, and as you've heard a little bit, we have an incredible panel today. I'd like to quickly introduce our panelists and then I will let them introduce themselves. But we have Tanisha Franks, who's the Deputy Assistant Director in Harris County. We've got Coletta Lynch, the Chief Equity Officer in Salt Lake City. We've got Olaremi Kufeji, the Manager of the Office of Talent Development and Performance Management at the City of Detroit Human Resources Office. And Susan Sloney, a Carlton County resident and former County Commissioner. Now, we heard earlier, but I'm going to read it again. CPI's definition of legitimacy is the broad reservoir of support and trust that allows governments to deliver positive outcomes for people. And I'm going to just call on you individually, but I'd love to hear from you. How do you define legitimacy and how does it show up in your own locality and how does that shape your work? So if I can give it over to you, Tanisha, first.
Hello, good afternoon to some. I'm on a different time zone, but legitimacy brought to our, I work in Harris County in the Houston area, and in our line of work, we see in the government entity from disaster items, from first responders, we all work together in different buildings. It helps because we are able to really focus on reviewing ourselves and our really going back to the drawing board with our mission statements and our vision and making sure that we are open mind, accepting, you know, our faults, dissecting them, and then applying things that can make them go away or partially go away. But we in Harris County Community Services Department, we try our best to be open to this. This is a new direction with the culture of working in government agencies. It can have some old school ways, the good old boy systems and things like that. So we've been open to it. I do have hope hoping that we'll be able to apply these very soon of what we learned. But that's what I have to share. I didn't go down the list of the questions right away, but sorry.
Okay, well, I'll keep us on track. Don't worry, that's my job. You just tell your story. Great, so Coletta Lynch, can you tell us a little bit about how you define legitimacy and how it's impacting your work?
Thank you so much, Jen. It's great to be here with you all today. The way we define legitimacy in Salt Lake City is actively listening and centering community voices. One thing that we do that we've really started to do lately is to identify who is missing from the conversation, because that is part of building legitimacy for us. And once we find out who's missing, inviting them to the conversation in a way that is open and provides a safe and courageous space for them to share. And then when we get them to that space, we also need to acknowledge the barriers and the challenges that have prevented them from being a part of the conversation in times past. And so really having an authentic and a vulnerable conversation about what the hurt has been for some communities that have not ordinarily been a part of the discussion especially communities of color. And then actually implementing and following up on their ideas. So community members share a lot of ideas with us on a daily basis, and we want them to know that they are valued and heard. And so I tell my team a lot, we don't just check boxes. Like, we follow up, we follow through, and we actually reiterate to community members that we heard you, we're listening, and these are the steps that we took in order to implement the ideas that you gave us. So that has been our journey so far with establishing earned legitimacy in Salt Lake City.
Great, thank you for sharing that. And Remy, how about all of you folks in Detroit?
Well, great, Jen. I think just taking a look at, you know, some of my panelists' feedback, you know, whether at the city, whether you are supporting internal or external customers, we want to make sure that everybody is connected and heard. And I think to reiterate, bringing everybody to the table and knowing that after we meet, that there are going to be steps afterwards as far as action items to make sure that we're moving forward in a progress. And definitely, you know, for our core team, our focus was disability affairs and improving the relationship between the city government and that community. And we wanted to make sure that when those voices are heard, you know, our listening sessions that we had, we wanted to make sure that, hey, there will be follow-up. There is a strategic plan in place by the Office of Disability Affairs, and that change will be made. So definitely that is our focus when it comes to how we view legitimacy.
Thank you for sharing that. And Sue, how about you all in Carlton County? You're muted.
Sorry, I thought there would be an automatic unmute, but it happens every single time there's a Zoom meeting, right? There's somebody that speaks. Anyway, thank you, Jen, and greetings to everyone. And I appreciate being here. I concur with the statements that are already previously stated, but I think legitimacy in Carlton County is increasing the community trust, demonstrating value in people's lives. And then especially in Carlton County, I think we're increasing the sense of community belonging. As a result of this cohort, of which I was initially brought on because of my past history, but as a result of the cohort, we were able to bring three recommendations to the county board. Number one was that, and they approved this, that they would take the information that we garnered from our listening sessions and include those with their strategic planning and budget processes. Number two, they, as John mentioned earlier, they agreed to two trainings for every Carlton County employee, one with diversity, the DEI training, diversity, equity, and inclusion, and in trauma, ACEs, childhood, adverse childhood experiences, so that the trauma informed is happening. The last thing that we proposed to them was that we would have a $10,000 grant of funding to be allocated to many community grants, because there was such a sense of belonging yet not being involved, or belonging. So it's a community get together grant that people can apply for to support community members interested in organizing events, projects, or other ideas just to build their community. That was released on March 15th, and it closes on April 14th. And so far we've got almost 10 applicants. So it's nice to see that at least one step was moving forward. So even though it's a small step, it's an important step towards more inclusive Carlton County, where we need to have a transparent approach and community members begin to feel informed, heard, and involved in the decisions. And I think that's what legitimacy is in Carlton County. Thank you.
Great. Thank you for giving us that illustration of how things have moved forward. So some of the things that I heard from all of you are, it's not only about what you do, but about communicating back to community, about looking for who is not there and inviting them in. And I love the language that you used, Tanisha, about a safe and courageous way to share. I think that's such a great way to think about it. And, you know, making sure that people really feel heard and that is internal to your colleagues and changing the way you work with one another as well as working with community. So thank you all for sharing that. So for everyone who's here today, we have a Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. So I have some questions to ask and we'll start off that way, but we would love to have your questions and please put them in that Q&A box and not in the chat because they get lost in the chat, but they get saved in that Q&A box and I can make sure that we bring them all to our panelists. So let me kick it off with a general question for all of you. I know that one key component of the program was the sharing power portion where you explored what co-creation is. So I wonder if one of you will talk a little bit about, first of all, what co-creating with residents is and how does that work and how does that help build greater trust with your residents? And I'll just open that up to any of you who want to share.
I can share, Jen. You know, with the co-creation process and taking a look at strategies that we can take in our decision-making process. I know our Detroit core team, we definitely have some great ideas working together to brainstorm and also included with that is our community partners and the invitation of having a forum for our residents as well. And the great thing about it is we were able to identify some of the concerns of some of those residents, such as improving response rate of some of our systems that we have in place with the city government to address community concerns, making sure that we could have additional support for residents who struggle with technology, an awareness campaign internal to the city of Detroit for employees, and having a mindset shift to be more inclusive, for our community as well, and making strides to improve in our housing as well as transportation environments when it comes to the disability community, and then making sure that there's a variety of community meeting forums so our residents have a platform to voice their opinion. So just taking a look at those, the feedback that was coming from residents and how we were able to make them feel comfortable, we were able to let them speak and hear their passion. I think it was definitely a successful, co-creation sessions that we had within our Detroit core team.
Thanks, Remy. Does anyone else want to share your experience with co-creation?
I would like to add we have a homeless advisory board. And so during our homeless, our co-creation, one of the individuals that attend our homeless board, which is a community person that has had the experience of homelessness. And so having her voice at our table, that was very beneficial to us. But I felt that when I was able to do with Earn Legitimacy, they had us do another meeting where I was meeting with a developer and listening to his views on the process with the city of Houston, with the county, with Harris County, and how applying for funds, applying to be to get a grant to have affordable housing, how certain departments do not communicate with one another. And we were, the other individual that I worked with at Harris County that was part of the cohort are looking at implementing something where the appraisal district website and the taxes, how certain departments are not communicating, which has some gaps in the system on when they're applying for these affordable housing things, it's all over the place. And so now we're trying to implement something where the gaps are going to be filled. And I'm really excited to see what will happen. It's not my department, but I wanted to speak on that. I work in the homeless programs, but they are implementing something soon. Well, we'll have the developers at the table. And it's difficult because it can be in conflict of interest because of the competition of the developers in the community. But this will allow more affordable housing in our community if we try to look at the gray area and make it where it's okay for us to have this dialogue with them. And they still too are able to apply and they're not looked at as a application. We still have to be fair and consistent with all the applicants. So I'm excited to see that's going to happen. Hearing a different aspect from a developer really helped us see what areas we have to grow in as far as communicating in different areas, in different departments, because Houston is so big, Harris County is so large, and we have to bring everyone to the table, like Coletta said.
I also agree with Tanisha. I think one thing that we learned through the co-creation in this cohort was how to break down silos internally, because the biggest thing for us was coming to the table and being open-minded, as Brian stated earlier. And in doing that, we did have a cohort member from the police department. And this member was very open about being in a space that was, they didn't always feel comfortable hearing the hard truth from the community, but they knew that they had to hear the hard truth in order for there to be a change. And so showing up in a space where community members were conveying to us that when we see the city, we don't see you as separate departments, like we see you as one city. And so whether you work in code enforcement, whether you're a police officer in the police department, whether you're in building permits, because we had people on in our cohort from Salt Lake City in building permits who participated. And I think that our cohort learned about the interconnectedness of what we really do as one city and how something from one department can affect another department because community members are looking at us to operate as one city. So I totally agree with Tanisha on her feedback there.
I can just say real briefly that, you know, one of the things with the co-creating in Carlton County, you know, talking about community involvement, is that through these sessions, we really did find out that a one-stop shop doesn't meet everybody's needs. And what we have to provide, sometimes people are in our area because they don't want to have that provision. So it was very interesting to get both those perspectives from our residents and how can we offer accessibility to services, and how can we offer accessibility to broadband and food and everything like that. So it was a great discussion that we had amongst our people.
Great. Well, thank you all. I mean, I think that process of community co-creation is so critical. You all sort of touched on this. So one thing that happens often in city government or local government is that we're doing what we think our residents need. We don't always pause to listen to them. And I know each of you had to host community listening sessions and learning more about resident experience and resident desire. What was that like for you? Did you identify any key themes that came up internally or externally along the way?
I would just say this, being transparent with our policies and procedures to not only staff, but to the public was a huge issue. And hearing, that was the overall, I would say, one of the first main items discussed, especially when we met with the developer. And we focused on the affordable housing piece, just the policy procedures and the steps and the workflow of different roles and responsibilities and different departments, having that like Ms. Sue said, attainable to the community.
I can piggyback off of Tanisha. One of the things, you know, that I learned is, you know, even though residents are frustrated sometimes about the consistency of service from local government, one of the areas where it was a reoccurring thing was their passion about their communities and especially their fellow neighbors. And that even though they were frustrated, it hasn't caused them to leave the city. So, you know, listening to that, listening to the reasons why they wanted to stay, and emphasizing that in our listening sessions kind of helped me realize that, you know, people actually do care, and kind of making sure that, you know, on my end, as well as, you know, some of my core Detroit core team members, making sure that the residents felt that their voice was heard, letting them speak, not interjecting. And it was almost like a sense of relief after the session. So definitely took away some great best practices that I can incorporate in my role.
I would just like to say that our listening sessions were, we had two listening sessions. One, we had a face-to-face and it was like a cold December day. I think it was like 20 below. And then we had a Zoom meeting the next night. We actually had more people that were face-to-face there. There was also a sense of a political undertone at that meeting, which we were very concerned about, challenging our cohort about what the money was being used for, where did we get the money for this? Why are we trying to use this money for the cohort and not give it to people within the need? But I think that one of the things that happened because of this listening session, you know, we're a very strong community. We have a sense of protecting ourselves, being resilient, yet then on the other side, because there are people who have been here forever, and I've been in this community for over 30 years, and at times I'm still an outsider, but there's that sense of, because we may be an outsider, how can we get people together? And that listening session is what brought us that community grant. That was where that idea was created. That's where it was fine-tuned, and we brought it to the board and it was passed. But one really light bulb moment for me, and if you just bear with me for a minute, but out of that listening session, Carlton County's biggest community is like 12,000. And otherwise they're 1,000, Moose Lake is probably 1,200 or something like that. But otherwise they're 300, 250, 152. So it's interesting to bring that back into the perspective of when we're planning for Carlton County. And one of the conversations one night was about the food desert. For 30 years, I keep forgetting that people have to drive 30 miles to get to a restaurant or 30 miles to a grocery store. And we forget that when we're trying to say, come on up here and get your services in this area. We have, you know, in the county seat or the big city, we have your services, come on up and get it. But they're driving 30, 40 miles just to get to that. And one community member kept talking about the food desert. The only thing that they have to purchase food is the convenience store gas station. And so it was kind of a light bulb moment about how can we utilize our small operational farms and try to start bringing food on a regular basis out there for like a traveling grocery store to speak of. So I think that listening session was great in that piece for us.
And the theme that we saw in Salt Lake City for our listening sessions and our co-creation sessions was connection and communication. So the biggest thing that we heard from residents was, you know, a lot of times we put things out via email or we post it to our website, but people really were unaware that we had as much work going on in the city that we did. And we had to take accountability for that to be like, what streams of communication are we using? And how could we do this better? Another thing is connection. So when we initially got in those co-creation and listening sessions, we didn't immediately tell them everything that we had done at the city. we listen. Like, that was the purpose of us being there. And so we wanted to create a space where they knew it was not just a political checkbox for us. We weren't just doing this as a one-time thing. There was going to be follow-up. But in addition to that, we were there to listen to them and ask them questions to get their feedback instead of us coming to present everything that we worked on to see if they agreed or disagreed. And so I think we found a lot of value in that, because we are actually still continuing these listening sessions and working groups together with the community through our Racial Equity and Policing Commission. And one of the markers that we implemented recently is so the Racial Equity and Policing Commission is one of the most diverse commissions that we've seen in Salt Lake City. It consists of community members and community leaders. And so they make official recommendations back to the mayor that she is currently implementing. And we have put funding behind it in order to implement those changes that the commission recommends. But I think one of the biggest things is they feel like they're being heard because they actually see action going on now. So they made a training curriculum recommendation for how police officers go through training when they first join the force. And they wanted a specific piece to be put in about how policing came about in the history of policing, because they found that in their observations, that was something that's not taught initially in the training for police officers. And we worked very closely with the police department and the police chief to get that recommendation implemented immediately. Like right now, they are working with the commission to actually vet consultants from the local community to do that training piece. So connection and communication was the biggest for us.
Yeah, thank you all for sharing. I think, you know, facing those hard truths can be really challenging. And I think also for those of us who are experts in our fields, walking in with humility and walking in to just listen and not share all the work we're doing. And for any human, not being defensive when someone is holding us to account is a really challenging practice. So I think it's critical for all of us to pause and be able to listen and to be able to hear the hurt that people are facing in order to try to address that. In line with that, I know that this process for cultivating trust and really building those relationships at the speed of trust, it can be very slow and it can be difficult and stressful and require us to overcome many barriers that we didn't create or we didn't intentionally create. So what has kept you motivated or given you that sense of hope to keep going in a journey that understandably is a slow process in winning back our communities? And Coletta, I'd like to put you on the spot. Yeah, to kick us off.
Yes. Thank you, Jen. The motivation for us is that people keep returning to the conversation. We noticed at the beginning of this process, we did have a hard time getting people to the conversation, even after we invited them. But the consistency piece was big for us. We kept going back. We kept putting out the ask for them to come and engage in conversation with us. And, you know, the biggest thing is they keep showing up, whether the feedback is good, whether they feel like they've had a negative experience, they're showing up to share that with us. And we are taking their ideas and implementing them and resolving them on the back end. I think the other thing that has given us hope is more staff members are getting involved also. They are seeing the value as to why they need to be a part of the conversation to listen first instead of acting first and not asking what a community needs. And so I think, Jen, you mentioned it earlier about not being defensive. We had to have hard conversations internally first to say there is value in us doing this. And even though the mayor's office doesn't provide direct services, we support the departments that do. And so having our leadership put that message out there first to say this is important, this is a priority, and we need to show up to these conversations first from our end and be non-defensive to start the conversation carried a lot of weight, and it was really big.
So I'd just like to say that as I am a community member, I am not involved directly with any government entity. So this whole part of this, I have to remember I'm a community member. And I think one of the reasons that I think you mentioned it, it's the sense of hope that keeps people coming back. There's a sense of hope that there may be change. there's, you know, the fact that we've got this grant, we're moving forward, it's transparent. It's showing that there is some movement forward, and that gives us hope. So I think that's basically why I keep coming back to this, is that there's the sense of hope of change.
Great. Tanisha or Remy, you have anything to add?
I guess I can add one point. You know, definitely, obviously, it's a long journey when it comes to improving awareness. So for the city of Detroit, we definitely wanted to put an emphasis on employee awareness. And, you know, one of the highlights since the completion of the cohort was the city of Detroit formed an employee resource group for disability awareness. And actually, there was a recent event, a lunch and learn with Justice Richard Bernstein, who is the first elected blind justice to the Michigan Supreme Court. So having those events, making people aware that the city of Detroit has a support from the top down from Mayor Duggan, as well as our Director of Civil Rights, Inclusion and Opportunity, Director, as well as our Christopher Samp, the Office of Disability Affairs Director, definitely makes these initiatives sustainable, and knowing that it's not just falling on one person, it's a support, you know, from the top down. So definitely encouraged to look at what's to come, and definitely being a part of those initiatives.
I guess my sense of hope is that in the cohorts, I think sense of hope, I could speak for us a little bit to say our executive director with the community services department, Dr. Holloway, is we presented in front of our commissioner's court and they do want follow-up, and we are in the process of getting ready to present in front of multiple leaders because Harris County is so large. It is difficult to get everyone together, but I think that's going to be happening very soon. And our exec is on board. So that's my sense of hope, that they listened. They're eager to hear our next steps, but the buy-in process is still happening. And that we're discussing the buy-in process. We're planning the buy-in process. So that's my sense of hope right now. And we do have some new positions that I appreciate in our department, which is like a policy analysis, where we're really focused on our policies to see where things can be adjusted, especially looking at, you know, systematic racism and things like that. So I'm excited to see that those policies have been, those positions have been created, but we still have a ways to go.
It's like you read my mind about our next question. We've got some great questions from the attendees today. And there's a few I'm going to try to roll into one question, but you all mentioned involving groups that were not in the room. So how did you go about that? How did you identify them? And what worked and didn't work in bringing those people and different viewpoints into the table?
We work with organizations and community organizations that already had earned legitimacy in the groups that we were trying to reach. So we reached out to leaders and we asked them if they were willing to partner with us up front to help us invite people to the conversation. And many of them were. We did get pushback from some organizations that, you know, realistically, they didn't want to be involved because of the historic barriers and the challenges of building trust. But for the most part, the majority of them were open and they were excited about the possibilities to build relationship. And they also felt like it was really genuine and authentic from us. And again, that we were not just trying to check boxes. We also made some follow-up action items and agreements with those groups to say, this is what we're going to look at over the next few months. And we asked them to help hold us accountable, that if they didn't see the results that we had promised, that they bring those back up to us to ask us and hold us accountable for what we're doing. So that's how we started the process.
That's great. We have a question about evaluation too. And I'm thinking, I just heard you say you basically co-created what your evaluation measures might be to see if you were actually reaching them. That's great. Anyone else want to share how you got the voices that weren't in the room into the room and how you hold space for some of those different viewpoints?
Because transportation is a huge issue in our area. We offered transportation services. We was aggressive with reaching out to people. And I think one thing I'll say in leadership is, yes, you can, one thing we discussed with Brian and John, we said, how did it go? We said, some of us have large responsibilities and our positions did not allow us to have that time to really, engage and try to reach out. So really look at your teams and look at the people who may have that time with their workload and delegating specific items to those individuals that have that time. Because a lot of leaders was on our, but we're like meetings constant. And sometimes like, oh, I got to do this. But really try to look at your resources on your staff that can really help out and is eager and is happy to be part of something like this. And so that's what I did, the master of delegation. But I made sure it wasn't just like I just threw it at certain people. No, I really looked at their workload. I really, took time to see who had the time to help engage with the community because the community is busy. Their phones may not work. They can only text because they have a government phone and they're out of their minutes. It's just all these different things that we looked at, but we did offer transportation. We did follow up. We did, hi, looking forward for you to come tomorrow. So I think really doing that customer service, making sure our customers get there was what we did. So it was hard, but we did it.
Sounds like old school community organizing to me, just getting on that phone like, hey, meeting's tomorrow. Hope you're still there. Still count on you.
I just want to say, Tanisha, we did a lot of what you did and my being one of the community co-chairs, that was part my responsibility too. But we also have a program Well Within Reach and they have a coffee talk in which they called many people and did some interviews with them prior to this event. And so we used them and then just we did it in the newspapers, we did it online, but that's not always accessible to everybody. So we did make phone calls ourselves. We did the grassroots calling people and asking them, offering them a gift card. Also helping with transportation. So that is how we did it too.
Great. And we have a question about what inspired you to be part of this? There are many jurisdictions that have, I will say, earned illegitimacy, but not everyone wants to take the time to put the effort into rebuilding that relationship with community. So what inspired you and your community to pursue this program with CPI?
So I'm the first chief equity officer for Salt Lake City. And we recently just formed the mayor's office of equity and inclusion. And even though I've been at the city in previous roles, I pursued this because I knew that in putting together the citywide equity plan that we're working on and also helping to manage the racial equity and policing commission, that we had to build legitimacy in a way that's going to be long lasting and also establish a basic foundation as a part of this new team in order to do it. And so I wanted to, one, hear what other cities had done and hear about best practices, but also hear about their challenges so we could learn from them. But I think the other biggest piece from this cohort that I got was we had our learning liaison. And when I read up on the program and read that we were going to be with our learning liaison and they were going to provide methods for how we start to build better connections with communities, I was all in because I knew that it was something that we needed to change at the city and improve upon. And so I really just want to give a personal shout out here to Brian, our learning liaison, because we never felt like we were alone. And he answered all of our questions and gave us all the information that we needed in order to thrive in this process. So thank you.
Great. Thank you for sharing that. Anyone else want to share your story?
I guess I can chime in, Jen. From my perspective, my role working with the Office of Talent Development, we work more with internal customers, but definitely having an opportunity to kind of hear feedback from residents, especially some of, you know, based on the communities that we were targeting in our Detroit core team group. It's a way to kind of see the connection on how, what, you know, what we provide from the office that I'm a part of, how, you know, improving people's skill sets can impact the services for the citizens of the city of Detroit. So, you know, looking at some of the challenges and knowing that I'll be able to collaborate and hear best practices from other cities as well, gave me that foundation and knowing that, hey, it is going to be work to be done after this cohort, and knowing that, hey, as long as the right people are involved, it can be progress long term.
Great. Thank you so much. So I know I could listen to you talk all day, but we only have another couple of minutes. So this is our last question, and my apologies to everyone whose question didn't get answered. You have great questions in the box, and we're just not going to get to them all. But our final question, and I'd like to just hear from all of our panelists, is now that you've done this process, why is legitimacy so important to the well-being of communities? And why would you encourage others to participate in this type of learning work? Don't all jump in at once now.
So legitimacy is important because it helps to build necessary relationships in order to provide services and to implement programs that support and that support the community in a positive way. Like oftentimes, and this was mentioned earlier, in government especially, we assume we know what's best for a community and we put it into place and then we find out later down the line it doesn't work. And so building that legitimacy helps you to start in the process from listening to the community. One of my favorite sayings is nothing for us without us. So start with the people first in order to build a long lasting relationship.
I can, you know, basically take a look at a perspective of knowing that as administration may change or people may leave in certain roles, definitely it's an opportunity to have something structured and in place so residents will not be able to compare the services when, you know, certain administrations are on board. It can be consistent. So building that trust amongst the residents and communities will help garner that trust and understand that there is a seat at the table for all of our residents, that we want to make sure that they're heard and that whatever feedback that they want to give, they know the outlets to go to. So definitely from that perspective, legitimacy, you know, it, like I said, it shouldn't matter who's in charge. It should be, you know, coherent in all of the departments that we want to impact and making sure that there's not a, you know, just a lack of attention to it.
Great, Tanisha.
Yes, I'll just add as soon as you said that lack of attention piece of it. So I came on to this cohort because of my past experience in the county. I'm a former county commissioner, and a lot of the things that they were working on or potentially planning to work on with this cohort were things that I was passionate about before. I was very passionate about the communities and the involvement and building relationships in the community. So one of the interesting things about the interviews that happened was when I would call them and ask them about their relationship with the government, the first thing they asked me was which government. And so many of these people in the smaller communities really felt a trust with their township officials. They felt that township officials, there was a trust. And as you, maybe it was because they were able to communicate more directly with those people. But then as we moved up the bigger government bodies, there seemed to be that lack of trust. And I think it is so important to build those relationships outside, have those conversations so that we can have a sense of trust at the bigger government as well as the smaller one. So that's my passion. I see where time's up. So go ahead, Tanisha.
I'll just be quick. The values that's listed for legitimacy is curiosity, open-mindedness, humility, accountability, and equity. And those are the key factors that I guess I was voluntold to do this. But when I saw that, I said, oh, I love this. We need this. Every local government entity, like I said, from first responders to we pay rental assistance or utility assistance. But really taking a look at yourself as an agency and as a person to see what you bring into the community and understanding their voice and being open to really listening. And instead, like she said earlier, we like to present what we did and what we do. We have to slow down with that and really just take time and listen to the voices that we are there to service. So that's what I'll say in closing.
Great.
And I love Brian too. Shout out to Brian.
I'll share that shout out to Brian for sure. So I know that we're just really, really short on time. I just want to say the things that I heard loud and clear are it's important to listen, to build relationships with other credible messengers to help us build those relationships, to pause. And to, I think, Tanisha, you sort of said this right at the end, we have to rehumanize ourselves. Often in city government, we've sort of become just doers and not beers. And so to rehumanize ourselves and reconnect to our residents on that human level. And with that, Jorge, I'll turn it back over to you. Thank you very much to all of our panelists and to everyone who asked questions today.
Thank you, Jen, and our panelists. While we could keep talking about government legitimacy, our program is sadly coming to a close, but I did want to just mention again something Coletta Lynch, our panelist from Salt Lake City, said: connection and communication. Connection and communication. That's really what the Earn Legitimacy Learning Cohort was all about. And I think I speak for everyone when I say that there's a lot more work to be done. Now, we have two requests for you before you leave. One is an exit poll. We really, really, really love feedback, and we would love to have your feedback on today's webinar so that we can better support you in the future. Also, we have a follow-up form. We would love to continue this relationship and would love to continue learning alongside all of you. So if you're interested in deepening your connection with Earn Legitimacy, working with us, our team will be sharing potential partnership opportunities if you complete the form that we're dropping in the Zoom chat. So you should see all of that in the chat or showing up on your screen now. And while folks are finishing up, I just want to say thank you one more time. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone in attendance and for your attention. This webinar and the broader cohort really took a lot of people to make it happen, far beyond CPI. So you all of you really do, we love you and we appreciate you so much. All of you really do have a deep, 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 deep impact in making this work so substantial and so important. To our cohort members, today represented by Tanisha, Coletta, Sue, and Remy, thank you again so much. You're really just a small part of the bigger cohort of Harris County, Salt Lake City, Carlton County, and Detroit, respectively. So we want to really share with all of you, even those of you that weren't panelists today, again, another big, big thank you and shout out. You continue to inspire us with your dedication and talent to continuing the work. And last but not least, to our marvelous moderator, Jen Steinfeld from the National League of Cities. You really brought your passion, enthusiasm, and energy. You really, really moved not only the panel, but us too. So thank you. And last but not least, our team at CPI. You met some of them today on the design team and our learning liaisons. But really, there is a family and a team of people at CPI that believe in this work and want to continue doing it and bringing you really in many ways what we thought was an impossible dream to get cities to want to really work on this with us together. And there's so, so much more to come. Thank you so much. Have a great day, everybody.